Welcome to my talk show. So it's nice to connect with you all on this episode of mine. And as an MC celebrating 10 years of my journey, it's been a wonderful moment to have a very special guest today on my show who's 30 years experience in not just as an MC but with a lot of creative arts. So he's a singer, he's a script writer, he's a DJ, he's an MC. So a lot more I can say, and I'm sure you're very much excited to see a person who's multifaceted, multi-talented. I'm very, very excited. So I'm not going to waste my time. So let's go in and check who that special person is. A very warm welcome to my talk show, Nabarun. Thank you so much for making it.
Thank you, Monisha. And thank you for having me.
My pleasure. It's indeed my pleasure to have you
thank
here.
Thank you so much.
With a wonderful experience of 30 years as an MC.
Not just as an MC.
Also a DJ and you've been a lyric writer and a lot more. I'm sure that we're going to keep that little suspense so that a lot of people have lot to hear about you. Yes.
Okay.
How it began and how you realize that you're a very good stage personality. It's in you. The gene is in you. How did you identify that?
See, I was studying in the school called Assan Memorial, which 30-35 years back, I think that was the only school which had a 1,000-seater auditorium with a balcony.
Oh.
Inside the school.
Wow.
So I had broken my leg in the 10th standard vacations, and I couldn't play football, which was my passion. I didn't know I can sing and all. So during the PT period, the PT master made me go and sit in the auditorium. There was one teacher teaching some Saragama Padadisa and all that. And I was on crutches. So I had nothing else to do. I went and sat there. And from there, I picked up music, just like that.
Nice.
And then I got the opportunities to sing in culturals and here and there. And then next thing I know, I went and joined an orchestra, a professional orchestra run by Chandru and Gayatri called Friends Orchestra. And from there, one thing led to the other.
So how did you, get into RJing? Because I see that you've done different flavors of, creative arts. But then from singing, how did RJ happen and how did MCing happen?
Okay, it went one by one. From singing, I have traveled all over the place singing. I had started my own band. We have played a lot of places across the globe also. And then from there, I graduated into DJing. And then RJ happened by fluke. I had gone to the Times, they had a event company called 360 Degrees. I had gone to meet them, and a friend of mine, you must be knowing, a very famous voice called Niladri Bose.
Yes.
He dragged me into the Radio Mitchi office, which was owned by the Times downstairs, and said, come give an audition. I gave the audition and I passed.
Wow.
And there I go. I was one of the first RJs to open the channel.
Wow.
So we started this show called Hello Chennai, which was daily morning live 7 to 11.
Wow. First
on
RJ.
Radio Mitchi.
First
Radio Mirchi.
Okay, Radio Mirchi's first RJ. That's a very proud moment.
I mean, we were a whole bunch of RJs who started it. I did the first morning show.
Got it.
So, one of the RJs is a very famous actor now called Shiva.
Yeah.
Shiva, then RJ,
yes.
Suchi,
yeah.
RJ, there were quite a lot. Ajay.
Yes.
So, a lot of them. Sendil was very famous. Quite a bit. It was about 6 months till Mr. Maniratnam saved me. He came as a blessing in disguise. And he called me for acting in his Hindi feature film called Yuva. I acted in the Hindi version.
Right.
Because I've done a lot of dubbing. That's another aspect which I do. From Roja to a lot of Maniratnam films, I've dubbed, including his original Hindi called Dil Se. That I've given quite a few voices.
Wow.
So when they were looking for actors in Yuva,
right,
with live sound,
right,
who could speak Hindi properly.
Got it.
So I was called. It was a God-given opportunity. I mean, the great Maniratnam. People stand in a line to act in his films. And here I was called. And I got a pretty decent role. I was with Mr. Ajay Devgan throughout. And I got to meet huge amount of personalities who became my good friends later.
Wow.
I worked with Anurag Kashyap.
Oh.
He was the the dialogue writer.
Yeah.
Abhinav Kashyap, his brother. He also worked in the film and acted with me. He went on to direct Dabang. Then we had Shahad Ali, who directed Bunty or Bubbly. He was an assistant. Actors Siddharth and Karthi, they were assistant directors.
So people on my channel, you know, they know me as an MC, they know you as an MC, and of course they know you in different other flavors. But then all of them there must be wondering, this guy has done so many things, but how did he come into MCing? That's the question they're going to ask. So you have to tell us that journey.
I told you, I used to see people announcing. Now, the point about MCing, you know, is that that's how I even got through the radio audition, which later the person who was auditioning told me. He said, when you were talking in the audition, you're talking as if you're talking to a friend, but I was talking to a wall.
Right.
So I imagined a person there.
Right.
Like I'm talking to you now. Suppose you,
move
away.
I'm not there. Yeah.
I can imagine you're here and I can have a conversation with you.
Got it.
Okay. Now, when you're talking to an audience, you should connect to the audience.
Right.
Connect in a positive way, in a very friendly way, because the audience is a person who might be sitting on the other side. But a lot of them themselves are also nervous. You'll notice when you go to them and ask them a question, you should make them very comfortable.
True.
Communication is the key. The whole idea is communication.
So can you just do, you know, maybe think that, you know, you're going to give me an award?
Uh-huh.
Because that'll be fun. You're going to just go live just about, you know, giving, how would you script it?
So the award, ladies and gentlemen, for the best MC in Chennai, only because of one single reason, that she is interviewing me. So that award goes to the beautiful Monisha. Unfortunately, I could not find flowers which are as beautiful as her. We'll have to make do with these. But please give a huge round of applause for the gorgeous Monisha.
Wow, that was really sweet.
Language is very, very important. And I'm very, very finicky about this. If you are addressing a Tamil audience, please know a lot about the language and the culture. Tamil Nadu people love entertainment. They love movies and music. Learn a lot of knowledge of that. Give references to film stars and music when you're talking. If you're working with a North Indian audience, it's a must you must know Hindi. In English, I have seen, unfortunately, a lot of MCs going totally wrong with the grammar. An MC once, I will not name, went on stage and said, "Now, ladies and gentlemen, get ready for this great extravaganza." I mean, there's no word called extravaganza. Okay, it's extravaganza. Trust me, any language, it doesn't take more than 2 or 3 months to learn on the basic platform. If you have hours and hours to sit on Instagram and Facebook, you have time. Language, again, is nothing but a tool of communication. As an MC, you're here to communicate. If you don't have the tools, you shouldn't be here.
Nabarun, you play with different creative arts. Okay, you're talented, you're blessed, that's really nice. But given a chance, you need to take only one career to pursue for a lifetime. If given a chance that way, what would be that one career? You can make a choice, singer, MCing, or
actually,
DJ, or whatever you like.
Lifetime is too long to do one thing. Lifetime is too short not to do one thing. Or not to do too many things.
I love it. I love that line.
Yeah. So, if you can do, you should do. Okay, but coming to your question on a different note, from the beginning, I have always enjoyed singing. In terms of health, it's the best lung exercise in the world.
All right, now since we're talking a lot about singing, I'm desperately wanting to hear you singing. So let's go for one.
Yen iniya ponnilave, ponnilavinil kanave, ninaivile pudusugam narararattada. Bhool koi humse na ho jaye. If I had to live my life without you near me, the days would all be empty, the nights would seem so long. Knew I see forever oh so clearly. I might have been in love before, but it never felt this strong. Our dreams are young and we both know they'll take us where we want to go. Hold me now, touch me now. I don't want to live without you. Nothing's gonna change my love for you. You ought to know by now how much I love you. Sun le, oh janam, main hoon param shivam. Tu hai Parvati, milna janam janam. Sun le Meenakshi, tu hi mera dil. Loot ke yu mujhko, chup kyun hai qatil.
Wow, that was really nice.
I have not been trained for anything. I've neither learned singing, I've neither learned DJing from anybody or MCing or anything. I've just observed, seen, got into it because in most cases I did not like what the other fellow was doing.
Right.
And I said, oh my God, I can do better. So I tried, I worked on it myself. But I was the first one in Chennai at least who introduced computer DJing. Much before laptops, we used to carry our entire PC and go everywhere.
Oh, okay.
So the digital DJing was started here by me.
Right.
Okay. And so was karaoke.
Okay.
Karaoke, the concept itself was started by me here.
Alright.
You know who's happier because I can do so many things?
Absolutely, your clients.
Yeah, my clients. Because now they can get one guy and pay for one fellow and they get the work done for four fellows.
Right, that's great. So how do you see the MCing industry progressing, you know, 10, maybe 30 years back when you started and now?
See, long back when we started, I don't think there was any concept called MC. There was only announcer.
Right.
There was nothing called a master of ceremonies, or maybe in a very, very few places they would have been. Today, if you look at it, not only do you have professional MCs, but even actors are good MCs. Singers right. have become MCs.
Right.
Okay, a lot of people are hosts now.
Hmm.
Okay, a person like Karan Johar or Shah Rukh Khan for that matter is a very good MC apart from them doing other things in life, an actor, producer.
Correct.
So, you have to have the knack or you have to learn how to twist and turn your presentations so that you can, you know, relate to the audience and more importantly, they can relate to you. It is more of a self-learning thing and how you want to go about doing it. Nobody can really teach you any of these things like in a school or telling you what to do. It should come from within. Like I told you again, observe people, learn to love them, learn to want to communicate with them. You can do it.
Like maybe at least, you know, 10 years down, you know, because I started MCing about 12 years back. So when we started then, we never had something called the competition. We were so happy for each other and it was more fun. We were juggling events between us. And I think that time even more of a monopoly because we were 5 or 6 numbers and always it's just we had the show, mostly as female MCs, I would say that.
Okay.
But now as the industry is growing in huge numbers, so we see a lot of, you know, upcoming MCs, but then there's something called competition that within, that they're building within mm-hmm. is what I feel. So what's your stand on that? What do you think?
Personally, I don't believe in competition in the sense that it's not a pompous statement, but from day one till today, I don't think I have any competition except myself. I am my own competition. I should be better tomorrow than I am today. That's it. If you're good, you will always get work because let me tell you, a country like India produces the population of Australia, one Australia every year. Can you imagine how much of audience you're getting? But in terms of talent, they produce only 10,000 people every year. So that means you have 1 crore in audience and only 10,000 people of talent added. So going by the ratio, a talented person will always get work. Like you said 15 years or 20 years back, there weren't so many events happening. So if you look at it that way, today you have channel television, you have web, you have live events, even people who never threw a small birthday party needed an MC, they are doing that. They're calling MCs for a puberty celebration. So instead of breaking your head and you know increasing your blood pressure, worrying about what the other MC is doing, just work on yourself.
What do you think is really important as an MC when you go to a show?
First, most important is once you get into an event, own the event. It's not Monisha called me today, so I'm going. Today I'm doing the event, it's my event. So what you would do in your own house, you will clean up your house, you will keep things in place, you will dust it, you will keep it beautiful. Do that to an event. Don't wait for a client or somebody to give you inputs. Go and ask. Nothing wrong in that. Never be late for an event. Don't lose your mind and crib and complain if the event starts late. There are hazard factors, thousands of factors why it happens. Also, please remember the event manager is a human being who's handling a lot of pressure. Stop being one of that pressure. He's giving you work, respect that. Please make sure you're presentable. Please take care of your hairdo, whether you're, if you're a guy, please trim your clean shave. That's I'm on a clean shave, but people have a beard, but please trim it properly. According to the event, if it's formal, wear a blazer at least, if not anything, or a suit, depending on whether it's indoor or outdoor. You have to choose your clothes accordingly. Make friends definitely with the audio person. He is a man who does a hell of a lot of hard work. If you're good friends with the audio person, you will sound better. And however late the event goes, don't upset your mind. Do it well. Because this one event which you do well can translate into maybe 10 more events. People are noticing. They are noticing every small thing. I know some good MCs who have lost work because they have been a royal pain to the organizers. Or for example, you go out of station, you have been given a hotel room. Please ask the event manager before you order ridiculous things. You have been hired to give happiness to the people. Just give that and cut out. You'll forever be giving happiness, and at the end of it, even you'll feel great. Trust me, it works.
Okay, Nabarun, I really think when it comes to briefing, 10 years before or 5 years before, when MCs were called for a brief, we all love to just go and meet the client and get the brief done. Okay, we were like very chillax about it. But currently, I think all of our dates are so busy, super duper busy, that we all say half an hour before varan show ke apuninga brief panren. I am very good. I'm very capable. I handle everything. How do you see this? You know, when you see two different extremes of
actually, change. When I hear the word brief, I think of Chaddi and Banyan. So if they say, I'll give you a brief. I say, okay, no, I'm wearing my own brief. I don't need that. But jokes apart, briefing is very important, especially in a formal event. You know, so suppose you're not available that day. Unlike earlier, today you have WhatsApp, you have email, you have messaging services. You can tell them to send the data to you. For example, an award ceremony, there will be changes then and there.
Yeah.
They will be happening there. But then, the basic structure, if you get to know earlier, it's always good for you. If the client calls you 2-3 days before, but make sure you get your data. It's very, very important. Also, I forgot to tell you one more thing. Now, this reminds me. Mm-hmm. For a good MC or anyone on stage, please make sure you get good sleep. You have to look fresh. Food and sleep is essential so that you keep your energy up. The more energetic you are on stage, the audience can relate to you better.
Yep. That's right. And okay, now I've seen something, you know, as an MC, what I've seen most of the times is when I want to do an event, and I think, you know, gifts play a very important role in an event because it brings a lot of energy for the audience to come play or maybe even answer a question and get some goodie.
Right.
Now, there are times that, you know, when the client or the event organizers, they just say manage without gifts.
Mm.
You know, so that I really think is a very obstacle for you to keep going. Yes, you can do certain amount. But then if you have a goodie, I think it's a kind of a cushion for you to bring in more energy into the flow, is what I think. What's your feeling?
Yeah, see, no, definitely. Now, this is another aspect of MCing. It's called games jockey. Yeah. And when you're doing game, it's always essential to have some prizes. Even a small chocolate bar is great. Human beings have the tendency to be happy when they win anything. When the situation became in such a way that I couldn't
go and pick one.
Yeah, then I use my acting skills. So what I told them was that we are going to play this, and all the winners, I'm noting your name and your corporate ID number. On Monday morning, your bosses will give you something.
And you trap them on it.
Yeah, and they play with the same enthusiasm and all that. And then I give the list to the boss. I said, now it's up to you. Ball is in your court. Okay, but at least the hope that they'll get something
makes
it better.
That's a smart move.
It is just a small token of love and appreciation and fun.
Of course, I think there's a lot of difference, you know, in the way of handling when you have a small audience and a large audience.
Uh-huh.
The whole game changes when you have, you know, an audience is small, so you're very close to them and, you know, you get into them. And when it's a large audience, you're just like an ant over there. And of course, yes, gaining everybody's attention becomes really difficult. You hold few and you don't. That happens though. How do you think you know, we can handle? Or maybe you can say small crowd versus the bigger, larger audience.
A smaller audience is a... it's not that these are easy to handle, that is tough to handle.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
There are different methodologies of handling them. Okay, now you're doing a smaller audience indoor. It's very easy to do on one-to-one and amalgamate with them. Outdoor, for example, you're doing a beach side. Half of them might be in the beach.
Right.
Four people will run under the coconut tree. Three people will be this side. That also becomes a crazy thing. There, having a good sound system plays a huge role. So, get them in. And then you do your thing. Now, in terms of a large audience also, a large audience outdoor is very, very difficult. It's not only what you're saying, it's how you're saying it and not the subject matter alone. It's also the add-ons which you're doing, because people are anyway thinking of food. So talk about food, they'll live love you. But in a corporate, if that happens, where people are not responding, then locate the biggest chief of the organization. Interact with him, you make him happy, everybody is happy.
That's nice. Okay, so since you've been doing a lot of voiceover, dubbing, ad films, and you know, a lot of that, a lot of MCs actually think, you know, since they talk and it's all about talking, why don't I try voiceover or dubbing? I personally have a feel that, you know, they're two different extremes, way too apart, you know, to think of juggling, thinking both are of same skill sets. So how can you differentiate both in?
First of all, let me tell you this. There's a huge difference between using a mic on stage and using a mic in a studio. As a singer, I can tell you, there are singers who are very good on stage, very bad in a studio. And vice versa. A very good studio singer will be a very bad stage singer. There are some rare cases like S.P. Balasubramaniam sir, who is terrific in both avenues. For being a voiceover or a dubbing person, you have to know acting. A dubbing or a voiceover a skill is acting through the voice. A lot of them tend to shout on the mic. Everybody, you don't have to do that. Like I said, make friends with the audio guy. He will boof up. Everybody, please listen to me. That's enough. In a live, you can escape with a lot of things. In a recording, everything is recorded, including your teeth sound, your breath. In some songs, you'll notice some singers breathing. But some singers, you won't have the breathing sound. Right. Because they know how to manage it, these people can't. Now, suppose you have to sound like a very young guy. Mm-hmm. Hi, Monisha, how are you today? You sound like a very old man.
Hi, Monisha, how are you today?
You know, you have to manipulate your voice, you have to act. If there's a pain, if there's emotion, you have to show it through your voice. You're watching Talk Show with Monisha. You do that.
Yeah.
You're watching Talk Show with Monisha. Something like that. So there are different ways of doing it. There are two different planets.
Right.
The only common thing is voice. And the microphone, of course.
Right. That's, you have described it very clearly, differentiated between both of them so nicely. So thanks for that, Nabarun.
Oh, no, my pleasure.
So with that note, how was your experience being part of the talk show?
Oh, it's great fun because if I go by what happened today, it was more my talk show than hers because I kept talking. She didn't talk much. Talk show with Monisha, but talk show, continuous talk from Nabarun. So I hope I didn't talk too much.
So we welcome guests and we want them to share the experience. So that's where, you know, I give in the space. Of course, it's good to hear from you. So.
No, my pleasure. And incidentally, she's a very good MC herself. So no wonder the questions were so perfectly rooted because she knows the pros and the cons and the problems and the happiness of the industry.
Thank you so much, Nabarun, for being here on my talk show. And this is a small token of love from my end. I wanted to unwrap it and see and tell me how you like it.
Thank you, Monisha. Monisha's given me my gift stroke payment for the show. Let's see what is there. I like surprises, you know.
Oh.